Good morning, Richland Creek. Happy, Merry Christmas. We're not in England. Merry Christmas. And just wanted to get us started with an Advent reading this morning. Each Sunday in December, we're going to begin each service with just a reading of God's of Scripture, prophecies about Christ, scriptures from the Gospels about Christ's birth. And so let's stand together as we consider the good news of the Gospel this morning. We begin by considering the promise of the coming Messiah as part of a long line of prophecies that told us about the Savior that God was sending into the world. God spoke through the prophet Isaiah. In Isaiah 7:14, we read, "The Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel." Even though our sin had broken our relationship with him, God's plan was to send his son to be with us. Therefore, one of the names given to Jesus was Emmanuel, which simply means God with us. God also promised that his son would meet our deepest needs. In Isaiah 9, we read, "The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." The prophets looked forward to what God would do. We have the privilege of celebrating what God has done. So let's sing together.
Release us, let us find our rest in thee. praise this morning. You're so worthy of our praise. How amazing it is. We have a God who sent his son to come and be with us, to come be Emmanuel, God with us. What an amazing friend Jesus is to us, that he would love us that much to do that. You know, you may have recognized the melody that we just sang. A lot of times in music, we reuse these melodies over and over again with hymns. There's another set of words that we're going to sing. Let's sing together, Jesus, what a friend for sinners.
Jesus, what a friend for sinners. Jesus, lover of my soul. Friends may fail me, foes assail me. He, my Savior, makes me whole. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Hallelujah, what a friend. Saving, helping, keeping, loving. He is with me to the end. Jesus, I do now receive him more than all in him I find. He has granted me forgiveness. I am his and he is mine. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Hallelujah, what a friend. Saving, helping, keeping, loving. He is with me to the end.
Let's worship him.
Amen, church. You can take a seat. This morning, as the song said, Jesus, a friend of sinners, we must be too. And that is why, as a church, we partner with the IMB, the International Mission Board. And each December, we take up a Christmas offering, the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. And this opportunity that you have to give to missionaries and the International Mission Board, every single dollar that you give will go directly to support missionaries on the field. And As we give, the beautiful thing about the International Mission Board is that there's over 3,500 missionaries all over the world that are fully funded through our giving as churches, as Richland Creek does, so that missionaries can give their full efforts into serving and reaching nations with the gospel. So this morning, we're going to spend some time praying for the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, but we're also going to pray some time for our missionaries themselves. And to guide us through this prayer time, I want you guys to see the six components of missions, or what the IMB calls the missionary task. And each one of our missionaries that are sent out through the International Mission Board are trained in these components. And I want you guys to see, like, the strategy involved, that is important as these missionaries are prepared. But the most important things, if you don't take anything away from this prayer time, in the center, it says to abide in Christ. In us as a church, as we send out to people, as we help those who are going to share good news all over the world, we need to be praying that our missionaries would abide in Christ. Because no matter how much strategy we put into this, how much work, if Christ is not in it, it will fail. So join me as we pray for our missionaries. Father, what a privilege it is that Richland Creek gets to serve and love you through supporting missionaries. Lord, we pray for this offering that we are taking up this December, that would be fruitful and that the money would go for the advancement of your gospel. Lord, we pray for entry, that missionaries would have new and innovative ways to go and share the gospel, to reach nations, to reach people groups who have never heard your name before. And Lord, even if it's not innovative, Lord, just give us miraculous work through your Spirit that they may enter places for your glory. And Lord, once these missionaries are there, we pray for evangelism. We pray that you would give boldness to these missionaries, as sometimes they are persecuted, they are rejected. Lord, sometimes there's so much fear into sharing the good news. Lord, give them boldness that they would proclaim your name without fear. And Father, we pray for discipleship as they share the good news, that more people would come to know you, that there would be converts who would believe in you and glorify your name and trust in you alone. And Father, as that happens, we pray for these missionaries to form healthy churches. As they disciple and grow and teach the word to these people, that they would gather into healthy churches. Just like Richland Creek desires to be a healthy church, we desire the same thing for our brothers and sisters all across the world. So teach them in the word, in your word, Lord, that they would gather faithfully. Lord, we pray for leadership formation, that these churches that are formed all over the globe would not stay dependent on the missionaries that we sent. Rather, that leaders were formed, deacons, pastors, and all other sorts of leaders in these churches, so that the work will continue this generation and the next. Father, we pray for these leaders. And finally, Lord, we pray for exit to partnership. Jesus, just like we see in the New Testament, Paul's example, how he went from place to place planting churches and he didn't stay there, he left. And this is even how we have most of our letters in the New Testament. He would reach back out to these churches. He left them, but he didn't leave them behind. He continued partnership with them. So pray that we would do the same, that our missionaries would do the same, that as we leave these places, Lord, that the gospel partnership would continue, that we would continue to encourage our brothers and sisters. But finally, Lord, what we pray is that our missionaries would abide in Christ. Father, help us as Richland Creek, as a church, to encourage our mission partners, to send encouraging words, to pray for them, to send our money, Lord, that we believe that the work they're doing is for your kingdom. So, Lord, we pray for these efforts. We pray that maybe you would send someone from among us to be disciple makers, to share the gospel in places where the gospel has not been heard. Lord, we ask this in your Son's name, Jesus. Amen. Please stand with us as we continue to worship our King.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation now revealed. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without.
death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and rain. The heavens are roaring. The praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival. You have no equal.
His name is powerful. It's wonderful. Let's pray in that powerful name now. Lord Jesus, we thank you that your name is lifted high. Lord, you humbled yourself and became obedient to the point of death on a cross, and yet you have been exalted, and every knee will bow and every tongue confess. Lord, we bow our knee in this moment, God. We declare your lordship over our lives. Lord, we love you. We thank you that you have come. You are Emmanuel, God with us. You were in the beginning, and yet, Lord, you're here with us. Thank you for that eternal truth. I pray that our ears and our hearts would be open to your truth, God, that we would be humble as you were. Lord, we would submit to the will of the Father as you did. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Be seated, please.
Merry Christmas to all of you. I want to say Feliz Navidad as well. It's Christmas time of the year. We finally have the decorations up. Some of you have had them up for a month. You've been breaking the rules, but now it's okay to have them all up, right? So Merry Christmas to everybody today, and very, very excited to spend the next few weeks looking at Emmanuel and God with us today. If you have your Bible with you or a device you want to look on and follow along with, we'll find ourselves in Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, we'll be looking at a passage, just a part of that passage, looking at the birth, the incarnate Christ. And so we'll spend our time together today in Philippians 2. As you turn there today, I want to speak a little bit about our church and the Bible, really, leads us in this. Our church has two offices that we believe that leadership can hold. The first is office of pastor, but we also believe in the office of deacon. The Bible speaks about deacons as a area of service in the local church. Now, a deacon, what is a deacon? A deacon is a servant leader who's charged with leading ministries that in the church care for those in need. They fill gaps and in many ways care for the body of Christ. And so with the process for us as a church, it is coming up on time for us to bring on new deacons. Now, typically, that's led by our deacon leadership team as well as our pastors, but new deacons being brought onto our church leadership is something that the church body does. And I want to say before we do that, we as a church have been blessed over the past few years to have many faithful deacons who have stayed and carried out this office so faithfully. And so many of those deacons have served so well. Let's just praise the Lord for these dear brothers who have served our church. Now, I want to say this, that we've had a faithful deacon body, and one of the things we need to be doing is always adding more men to be serving in this role and continually adding qualified men to it. The last time we nominated and voted on them as a church, new deacons, was 2016. So it's time to do this again. And so the process today is one we're beginning right now, and it's really two halves. We'll nominate names as a church. Then we'll allow the deacon leadership and our leadership to go and figure out if these guys want to do it as well as if they're qualified. And then we'll come back and present those names to you on the backside of that, and we'll vote on them as a church. Now, saying all that, the first part is nomination. So this can only be done by church members. If you're a member of our church, you can nominate up to three names, and you can go onto our website. We have a link that you can find right there in your worship guide. It'll tell you where to find it. You can go right on there, enter your name, nominate there. If for some reason you want something more present at the next steps area, you can go right up to one of those desks there, and we'll be happy to help you nominate here as well. And so that's a little bit of our process. Now, I want to say this. Some of you men in the room today will be the deacons we'll vote on here in a few weeks. So you need to be praying about, some folks in this room need to be praying about how you might be serving in that role as we step further. But that will begin with someone nominating your name. So all that to say, healthy church means healthy leadership and healthy servant leadership. And so we want to value that by having deacons in our church and an active, strong body of those as we nominate. So today we begin our series now, looking as we come up on Christmas, that we're going to look at the name for the Lord Jesus is Emmanuel, but the name means God with us. And so as we get a little closer to Christmas, we'll start looking at the passages that actually say Emmanuel. But I want to take you today to a passage you may not think of when you think of Christmas, Philippians chapter 2. It's a text that speaks about the humility of Christ. But within that, there are a few verses that give us a window into the miraculous nature of the birth of our Savior. And so we're going to take Philippians 2 and to see exactly what it means to have God with us. And so if you have your copy of God's Word, turn to the passage. Would you please join us as we stand in honor of the reading of the Word of God? And we'll read verses 5 down through verse 11. So that's kind of the unit, that's a whole section of text there. But where we'll focus today will be on verses 6, 7, and 8. So beginning Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, the Word of God says, "Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. But he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every other name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for your presence here with us today. Lord, it is only by the grace given of your Son who came to be God with us that we now have your presence with us now. And so, Lord, we're thankful that when we gather today, we come expectant of what your presence will do. So, Lord, in us today, help us to see the glory of your incarnate Son and draw our hearts to worship him and him alone. For we pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. You know, the first time you see something new, it can be quite amazing. Some new technology or new invention that you get to see, it can be awe-inspiring. A couple of weeks ago, I was watching, some of you may have watched as well, watched where SpaceX has built this new giant, they call it Starship, that they're building to send people into space. It is the largest rocket ever built. They launched the second iteration of it just a few weeks ago in a test, and I'll be honest with you, I was somewhat interested watching this. I watched it on a video, and I can't imagine what it would have been like in person. I can't imagine what 56 years ago when they launched the first Saturn V rocket, which initially sent people in space, which at the time was the largest rocket in history. So I can only imagine what it would have been like to see these things for the first time. Now maybe you aren't a nerd like Candy tells me that I am, and you don't enjoy watching rocket ships take off. Maybe you remember other new things that you've experienced. You could go far enough back in time where you remember the first time you sat down at a computer. You remember the first time you got on the internet. Who knew what this thing was they called the World Wide Web, right? You remember these things when you experienced them and you were amazed by them, right? I remember, you think about the first time you had a cell phone and you didn't have to be attached to a cord in a wall and make a phone call, right? And then, before you knew it, the cell phone became a smartphone, right? And that was amazing to me. It had this touch screen and you had all the capability of the world and information right there in the palm of your hand, even down to a video. You could make a video phone call with somebody. It's amazing when you see some sort of new technology or something newly invented for the very first time. But what's interesting though, you might be amazed by it, but it only takes a little bit of time before the awe is worn off, right? Wow, this phone is really amazing. And then a few years later, you have it in your pocket like it's just normal life. In fact, I turn on it, I'll be in the middle of nowhere trying to watch a high definition video and it's loading slow and I'm complaining because it's not quick enough, right? We go from in awe of something to finding it normal. Each of us have this danger when it comes to the miraculous birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Christmas is a wonderful thing to celebrate this miraculous event in history, but just because we celebrate it every year, oftentimes we can become somewhat numb to the amazing nature of it. I love Christmas. The older I get, the more I like the trees and the decorations and the music. It's enjoyable to have Christmas time of the year. I think about the food and all that goes with it, right? So for me, it's not hard to build up the feelings of nostalgia, right? That's easy. But the feeling of awe and wonder that Christmas celebrates God with us. What an amazing thought. God is with us now. So let's take Philippians 2 today. See if we can break off some of that repetition in our life and get some awe of the miraculous birth of Christ again, to see what kind of love is on display at his birth. If I want you to see something today, I want you to see the love of Christ is displayed in his birth. It's amazing to see what it was for God to be with us. The birth of Christ, what we celebrate here at Christmas. So what I want to take is these three verses here in Philippians 2. We're going to look at before the birth of Christ, what happened at the incarnation of Christ, and then what followed that. So let's talk about what came before. Here's the first thing I want you to see, is that we can see Christ's love in what he left behind. What he left behind. Have you ever thought about what it was like to leave the glories of heaven and come down and be born here on earth? The Lord Jesus Christ was in perfect fellowship with God the Father, God the Son himself, and God the Spirit, and they enjoyed this wonderful fellowship, and then Jesus came down and was born in this cold, difficult, challenging world. In fact, there's a lot of mystery around this idea, isn't there? There's a lot of details. If you start thinking about how is it that God himself was born as a man, there's a lot of mystery here. In fact, that's normal. If it's God and we're who we are, it should be normal that we don't fully understand these things. But Philippians 2 gives us a small little window into the miraculous birth of the Son of God. So let's take verse 6. We'll start there. And we'll start to look back at where he came from. Look at verse 6 with me. It says, who, though he was in the form of God. So speaking of the Lord Jesus, we'll take the first phrase. We won't even skip past it. Though he was, a very simple phrase, but it means that before the birth of Christ, he was. He already existed. This means that the birth of Christ was not the beginning of the Lord Jesus. In fact, the Lord Jesus had always existed for all of time. He is eternal because he is God. So even at creation, Jesus is there creating. So he has always existed. But there's a mystery about this existence. I'll give you one little window into it. The gospel writer John recorded a prayer of Jesus. I want you to see one thing Jesus said. Chapter 17 of John, verse 5. Listen to what he said. And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed. So the Lord Jesus had this great glory with the Father before anything we see ever existed. Think of the perfect, glorious fellowship that God the Father and God the Son had. Because Jesus was God. Look at the verse. Who, though he was in the form of God. That's the phrase, He was in the form of God. The next verse will say he was in the form of a servant. This doesn't mean that he's somehow changing forms. You might think that. You might think that the earlier you say that he was in the form of God and then he becomes in the form of man. He's not morphing or changing clothes. This phrase literally meaning that he was God. The meaning that he had all of God's majesty, his own nature. He was both inwardly and outwardly God. He was not merely just a reflector of God's glory, but he was God himself in all of his glory. I want you to think about just how glorious the Lord Jesus Christ would have been before his birth. Think of all the glory. There is no higher or more glorious state to be in than God Himself in all of His glory. Think about all of creation for just a moment. You ever go places and you see things that are amazing, right? You might go to places here on this earth, from Niagara Falls. You can go see tall mountains. You can go see Mount Everest. You can go see amazing buildings we built here on this earth, from Buckingham Palace to the Empire State Building to the White House, or what other giant building we built that's glorious. I think about our inventions of transportation. You think about from planes to cars to boats to submarines to just think of all the things man has done, and think about how glorious it all is. All the creation, even in movies, we've taken it another step, and we've got these graphics where we can generate even more glorious thoughts. But all of those things are just a glimmer compared to the glory of the God who created it all. They're just a little small window into the glory of who He is. So can you imagine, just for a moment, if Jesus is in all of this glory, He is God, how far of a journey was it for Him to that manger in Bethlehem? We call this the condescension of the Lord Jesus. He condescends. He comes down to where we are. What a wonder and what a mystery of God with us. Notice even the rest of verse 6 with me. Who, though He was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped or held on to. In other words, though He's having the glory and the essence of God, He is God, He doesn't count that glory as something He can hold on to. He's not holding on to His own glory to His advantage. That's the point of this humbling text, right? We're supposed to be humble like Jesus because He didn't take on His own glory to His advantage. He does what we almost never do. He lays down His advantage for someone else. Unlike Adam or even us as Adam and Eve and us as mankind following that, we grab every chance we get to take every advantage for ourselves. But that's not Christ. He lays down His life for others. That's Him laying down His glory. It's tough for us to imagine, but just think for a moment. How far did Jesus come to be with us? What kind of journey was that? You know, as Christmas, we talk about Emmanuel, God with us. And so many times at Christmas, we talk about the manger and the birth of Jesus, and Mary and Joseph, the wise men and the angels and the prophecy. We talk about all these things. But have you ever thought about what kind of journey it was to be the glorified Son of God and then come down to be that baby in a manger? What a journey it was to be God with us. What a miracle it was to travel down to be with us. A little picture here for you. I don't mind in my house, I don't mind helping out when somebody needs something. Usually if I'm sitting on the couch and the dog comes up and he needs to be let out in the backyard, I'm happy to get up and let him out. If one of my kids walks up, they need something, I'm happy to hop up. Sure, what do you need? I'm ready to go, it's easy, it's no problem, right? I'm willing to help out. But my humble servant heart is tested the closer I get to bedtime. You get in your pajamas, brush your teeth, and especially on a cold night, let's be honest, you crawl up under those covers, and I lay there, you think about it, you lay there, and someone comes up and needs something. Your dog, your kids. What was no problem is now a problem for me, right? Maybe you have this, like this, I probably have never done anything like this, but if you're laying there in the bed and you're married, and maybe you had little kids, have you ever done that where you, it's almost like a game of chicken, and you don't move, like you're faking like you're asleep. I've never done it, babe, I promise. So that was a, I shouldn't lie in church. I'm sorry, guys, I confess it. But you're laying there because you don't want to get out of that bed, right? And so then if my kids come in and need something and I get out of the bed, you know what I want to say to them? I just want to look at them and say, do you know how much I love you in order to get out of this bed for you? Right? I care because it was no problem earlier, but the distance is further, right? In the same way, I want you to think about the Lord Jesus Christ. He left heaven and the fellowship of the Trinity and all the glories of it. And he came down to be God with us, leaving this glorious state to come to be with us. What a glorious miracle that is. Don't miss it. So many times we think about the birth, but think about what it was for God to be with us. And I'll press it there. Think about his love, right? God so loved the world, right? If you say today, I don't feel love today, just look at the Lord Jesus. He loves you. Every time we celebrate God with us, we celebrate God loves us because he came to save us. But this, the journey for Christ didn't just end there. It wasn't about where he came from, but it's also about what he took on. Here's the second thing I want you to see. We see Christ's love in what he took on. What he took on. You see, Christ left his glory behind, and as he left heaven, it did not mean that his humbling was over yet. You ask yourself, how did this glorious God become man? How is it that God himself walks the earth as a man? Now again, it's a mystery. In fact, verse 7 we're about to look at has had a fair bit of conversation in all of church history trying to understand it. So let's look at verse 7 and let's see what it meant for Christ to become man, to be born. Verse 7, look what it says. But emptied himself. So here he is. He sets aside his glory and he emptied himself. Now, what does it mean that Jesus emptied himself? We got to be careful with this one, guys. You start running off in a bunch of interpretation, you're going to speak heresy about Jesus, okay? So what does it mean when he emptied him? Because at first, it kind of sounds like he dumped out the divinity. He got rid of it. He emptied the divinity part and he just became man. But that's not true. He's not just emptying that out. Jesus never ceased to be God. He brought the whole of his divine nature into his earthly body. So he is no less God as he laid in that manger as a baby than he is right now standing in glory. So what does it mean that he emptied himself? Here's my favorite thing to do, is let the Bible define itself. So let's finish verse 7. What does it mean that Jesus emptied himself? Look what it says. By taking the form of a servant. Here, someone said it best, I think. He empties by taking. He empties by taking. He takes on the form of a servant. He becomes this servant. Now, to be clear, just like he was always God, he was always a servant. But here, for us, in his appearance and in his life, he is a servant to us. He's not giving up his divinity. What is he doing? He's taking on this flesh. Look at the last part of the verse. He empties himself by taking the form of a servant. How? By being born in the likeness of men. That's it. Emptying himself, being a servant. How? To be born a man. That's his identification. Here is the, what we call the incarnation of Christ, or what we celebrate at Christmas, the birth of Christ. He empties himself, becoming a servant, to be born as man. Now, it's been said about this verse, I thought this might be helpful, that it's not about what he emptied out of himself, but what he emptied himself into this man as a servant. So here it is, God himself serving sinful mankind by becoming a man. Here, Jesus identifies with us. The ones me and you who have rejected him, turned from him, and sinned against with him, the very Son of God, the King of glory, is a servant coming down to be with us. What a miracle of God himself. Imagine that. This is, I'll say, it's the ultimate episode of Undercover Boss, right? God himself coming down to take on flesh, emptying himself, being born as a man. Have you ever thought for just a moment about, we talked about the glory of Jesus in heaven. Have you ever thought about the humbling nature of his birth based upon where he came from? Think for just a moment with me. The glories of who Jesus is. And here he is, born to an insignificant family. Nobody knew Mary and Joseph. They weren't kings and queens. They were nobodies. And not only was he born to them, he was born in a place they didn't even have their house. They're put off in this manger, in this stall with these animals. And then, have you ever thought about how helpless and humbling it would have been for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the God of all the universe, to be born as a baby? Ever thought about a baby? How, those of you who've taken care of an infant before, how helpless is a baby, right? Can't feed themselves, can't clothe themselves. Every need that baby can't do for themselves. If I were to give you the picture of the beginning of this verse, that is emptying oneself, right? Jesus going from the glories of heaven, and here he is laying there. What's amazing? That little baby, the Bible says that Jesus holds everything in the universe together. And there it is, the one thing that whole, Jesus who created the universe holds it together, and it was made for him, laying in that manger helpless, needing someone just to give him food. That is the picture of Jesus being God with us. Now, I want to press it a little step further. This is the beginning of his identification with our sin. Many of you know the verse from 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I think we always think about this verse connected to the cross. Let me read it to you. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Most of us think of this becoming sin as the cross, right? This is where on the cross he bore my sins and he traded places with me. He took my sin, I took his righteousness, and that's absolutely right. But do you realize that the road to the cross begins at his birth? That his identification with us as sinners has the moment that he takes on flesh and is born here as a man. You see, at his birth, he is serving to identify with us, sinful mankind. He's coming down to be with us. I want to say this. A picture, maybe you've seen people do this that are in positions of leadership when they come down to serve others. I'm thankful some of you probably work in the restaurant industry. You're a waiter or server of some type, and you serve people that come in and eat in your restaurant. And I think that oftentimes we probably don't appreciate these servant-hearted individuals enough. Very thankful. It's a tough job, right? You got to deal with some difficult customers. At times, it's a dirty job. You got to go clean up the table. I don't know if I really like cleaning off table after everybody's eaten and it's all messy, and you got to come up and clean up that table. I'm very thankful for those who serve in this way. I'll just say a side note. We as a church, typically what we do is we come here on Sunday, we go out to eat after this. We ought to be, as a matter of witness, kind to those who serve us and a blessing to them. But having said all that, I've been at a restaurant before, and you'll see those waiting tables walking around, and then all of a sudden you'll see a manager come up. Now the manager, they've probably been there a long time, they've earned this position, and they could sit back in the back room and just kind of direct the traffic. But if you ever see when it gets real busy, the manager will come out and they'll jump in. They'll start refilling waters. They'll start cleaning off tables. They'll start jumping in to say, I'm willing to be part of the group. I can't imagine what it would feel like to be on the front lines working hard and then see my boss come in and say, man, I want to be right here alongside of it with you. Maybe you've had that experience in the place that you work. But this is an even greater jump for the Lord Jesus. So much of how we see the King of Glory, he now comes to be with us. He didn't just sit off up in his high tower and say, I can save you from a distance. He came down to be with us, to humble himself from his lofty position to be with us. I want to press on a word that, if you saw the bumper before we started, it's the word humiliation. Now, we're comfortable saying that Jesus was humble. He humbled himself. But if we were to press this further, there is actually an idea, and this is talked about, theologians and people call this the humiliation of Jesus. Now, I don't know if I've ever desired humiliation in my entire life, right? Some of the worst experiences of my life are attached to the term humiliation, right? I don't want to be humiliated. But I think of the Lord Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, laying there in a manger, identifying as one of the people who had sinned and rebelled against him, saying, I'm willing to be one of you, God with us. I think that is humiliating. It is what we call the humbling, the humiliation of Jesus, to go from the glories of heaven to a baby born here on this earth. But the humiliation of Jesus is not over. In fact, this is just the beginning of where it begins here and ends at the cross. Here's a third thing I want you to see today. We see Christ's love in what he would bear. Not just in where he came from, not just in what he took on, but what was ahead of him at this point in what he would bear for us. Christ was not just born to be born. He was born for a purpose. He came with a destiny to save us. So that takes us to verse 8. So we looked at verse 6, verse 7. Now let's look at verse 8. Look what it says. And being found in human form. So after he's born, now people see he's a regular guy. In fact, even after he does some of his miracles, people will say, you know what, isn't that just still the carpenter's son? They'll call him out. They'll think, man, he's just a regular guy. But Jesus was in a process of humbling himself, or the humiliation of Jesus. Look what it says. Being found in human form, he, by his own choice, humbled himself. This wasn't new. This was part of the core of who he was. So he humbled himself, and look what it says. By becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. So the humiliation of Jesus begins in the glories of heaven and ends at the cross. So when we speak of this, that's the trajectory, right? From his birth all the way to the cross. That's what we see here of Jesus being God with us. It was all part of the same journey. I relate it this way. Many of us here, I like a good routine. I enjoy routines. They help me stay on track on a day-to-day. And so I know for many of you here, you have a routine here on a Sunday morning. You typically, I don't stand out there and watch, but I think you typically park in the exact same spot in the parking lot every week. In fact, some of you, you've only been here a couple of weeks. We're going to commission new members here in a few minutes. They probably already have new parking spots saved in the parking lot too. And then you go from that same parking spot to the same seat in this room every single week. I know because I see you. It's like attendance. I've said this before, but I can do it. I kind of know who's where. So you go from the same spot in the parking lot to the same spot in here. Do you understand that that journey, the first step out of your car, is just as important to the last step to sit down in the seat? You don't get to your seat unless you take that first step out of your car. It's all one journey. In the same way, Jesus's journey to be God with us and to save us began at his birth and ends at the cross. The humiliation of Jesus, this humbling, being God with us, to identify with us. That's why I said he made him to be sin. It begins the day he's born. You see, that's what Christ did to save us. He took on flesh. But what's amazing to me here, and I've felt this the whole time I've been preaching, it's you take these few verses here. There's a lot of mystery still in what we've talked about today. I mean, I got more questions than I feel like I have answers today as I talk about this text. Well, if that was true, how did God, did God know these things, and how did he empty himself, and how did this work? There's so much mystery here. But just because there's mystery doesn't mean that you can't still have awe. You know, several years ago, Candy and I had the chance to visit the Grand Canyon. Many of you maybe have had that chance to do before. I'd grown up hearing about it. I didn't see it as a kid. I just saw it a few years ago, and I remember hearing it was this glorious sight to see. And so we traveled to go see the Grand Canyon. And as we're on, you know, we go there, we go stand on the side. And one of the things I believe is true, we'd always heard it, and you may say it's true. It's a cliche. You have to be there to see it, right? I can tell you all day about it, but you got to see it, right? And one of the things that happens, I mean, you walk up to the edge of the Grand Canyon and you look out over that expanse. And I'm telling you, it has every bit of what they say it has. You don't realize just how big and vast the canyon is. It's amazing to look at. You look across, you don't realize how far from one rim to the other end of the canyon's at. You don't oftentimes realize how deep it goes down. What's amazing to me is it's not just flat on each side. There's all these different rock formations, and it's just beautiful sight. What I realize when I'm looking at something glorious here is I don't have to know every detail about the canyon to be in awe of the canyon. I don't have to know just how deep it goes, how far across it is, what formed it, what kind of history it had. I don't have to break down every dynamic of the canyon to be able to appreciate how amazing that canyon is. In the same way, you and I, we don't have to know every detail about the incarnation, the birth of our King Jesus, to worship and be in awe of who he is. But I do know this. What brings about worship and awe is fixing our eyes on the Lord Jesus. You know, one of the things I did that day, we go up to the canyon. I remember going up to the edge of the canyon and looking out. And just think for a moment. If you were to visit the Grand Canyon today, this is not what you do. You don't walk up, do a quick scan. All right, let's go. You don't do that, right? You wouldn't spend hours trying to get there and all the dollars, look out and be like, got it, saw it, let's get out of here, right? What do? You go up to the edge, you stand, and you just look. You look over there and you see the depth of that canyon. You start seeing dimensions of things. You see stuff you didn't see when you first got there. You start to appreciate the depths and all of what is involved in that glorious creation. In the same way today, what we need to do to garner an awe of the Lord Jesus is to fix our eyes on him. You know, there's a lot of distractions that come at Christmas. I'm not here to hammer on all those other things. I don't know if those are our problem. I think our problem is we don't put our eyes on Jesus. So I ask you, do you want the awe of glory of Christmas? The miracle, the majestic wonder of God with us? If you do, fix your eyes on Jesus. And you know what's amazing? if you're not a believer here today, that if you'll fix your eyes on Jesus, the Bible says if you'll turn from your sin and you trust Him as your Savior, then it's not just God with us 2,000 years ago. There's a miracle that will happen in your life. The Bible says if you'll turn from your sin and trust in Him, then God will be with you. That's the gospel, right? That because of sin, we are separated from Him, and then He came down to live a perfect life that we could not live, die a sacrificial death in our place, rise from the dead in victorious life, so that if we would trust in that work when God was with us, that He would then be with us now. That's the glory of Christmas, is God is with you. That's the presence of God, right? What a miracle it is we have with God with us. Let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Lord, I confess to you today that it's easy to glaze over, to forget about, to become comfortable with the fact that you are with us right now. Lord, by the power of your Spirit today, open our eyes of faith. Lord, if we've gotten comfortable with it, open us back up to where we are in wonder and awe of your presence. What a miracle it is, God with us. Lord, I pray for those here that have never put their faith in you, Lord. I pray that they would turn from their sin, trust the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, today I pray they would experience an overwhelming presence of you, Lord. Lord, I pray today for us as believers in this room that you would get our eyes off of the junk of this world. As your word says, help us to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. So that, Lord, we might have an awe, a wonder of the mystery of who you are. Lord, you are God, we are not, and we declare our worship and our sense of wonder at your greatness today. We pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. We always close out our time singing and responding to the Lord. If you want to speak to a pastor or somebody, the sermon spoken to you into a way you want to follow up, there's pastors and other leaders down front that would love to speak with you today and pray with you. You can just come down while we're singing. But this is a moment for us to reflect, to worship, to get a sense of awe of the mystery of God with us. So if you'll stand with us today, have a chance to sing about the glories and the mystery of God and give Him praise.
The power.
Christ the Lord upon a tree in the stead of ruined sinners hangs the Lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption. See the Father's plan unfold, bringing many sons to glory. Grace unmeasured, love untold. Come behold the wondrous mystery, slain by death the God of life. But no grave could e'er restrain him. Praise the Lord, he is alive.
Amen, church. We are so excited this Christmas season to get to spend our time together focusing on the Lord Jesus Christ. It's going to be a wonderful time this month, and so I pray and trust that you will take full advantage of every day during the week, focusing on the Lord Jesus throughout the week. And so this morning, we're going to take a few minutes here at the end of our service to celebrate and rejoice in some folks who have finished the membership process here at Richland Creek. And as we think about church membership, just a quick announcement for you. We are having our family meeting right after this service. So if you're a church member, please make sure you stay for that as we're going to talk about the 2024 budget. But as we think about church membership, I want to go ahead and invite all of our current church members who are able and willing to go ahead and come down. We're going to surround these brothers and sisters in prayer as we pray here in just a moment. So go ahead and take your step out of your seat and go ahead and come forward. And we'll take a few minutes here to pray for these brothers and sisters. But as we think about the local church, we remember that it is made up of people who have been redeemed by the Lord Jesus himself. And so we rejoice that God has given us a local body to be a part of, not just to attend and to come and gather on Sunday mornings with, but to actually come and commit and be in relationship with, to be known by other people, to know other people, to use your spiritual gifts that God has uniquely given you for the good of a local church. And so we rejoice today that, as Pastor Mike just got done talking about, it is Jesus himself who unites believers together in relationships. And so today we're going to take just a minute and we're going to pray for each of these who are committing to church membership. You're going to see their names on the screen behind me. So I would just ask that each of you maybe grab a name in your mind as I pray out loud. You'll pray for them. And then we'll be dismissed. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you. God, we thank you, Lord, that you, through the shed blood of Jesus, for all that believe by grace through faith in him alone, you have brought us into your family. You have adopted us as your children. Father, you have brought us out of darkness and into your marvelous light. You have put a new song in our mouth, and you have given us a new identity as your sons and daughters. And so, Father, we thank you for these families represented here who have tasted and seen that you are good. God, you have saved them by your mercy and your grace, and they have embraced the Lord Jesus for the forgiveness of their sin. And Lord, we rejoice in that good news. And it is because of their salvation in Christ that they have committed to join this family of faith. And Father, they have met with our pastors, they have gone through our church membership process, and it is our joy today to welcome them into the family of Richland Creek Community Church. And so, Father, we pray for them. God, we pray that you would use their spiritual gifts uniquely for each and every ministry of the church, that every member of this body of believers would benefit because of their spiritual gifts. Father, we pray, Lord, that we as a local church would come alongside them and help them grow in their love and understanding of Scripture. God, that we would invest in them, that we would equip them, that we would allow them to use the knowledge of Jesus to transform their families, their neighborhoods, their workplaces. God, that they would be intentional to take the gospel wherever you would send them. Father, we pray that, Lord, they would build meaningful and deep relationships here at Richland Creek. Father, they would be known by other people and that they would be known by you. Father, we do pray, as Caleb shared earlier in our service today, God, we know that, Lord, you may be calling some of these even standing here today to the nations. And so, Lord, we pray that you would fan the flame of missions in their lives and in ours. God, that each of us would be faithful to proclaim your good gospel to the ends of the earth. And Father, we thank you again, Lord, for these families who are committing to local church membership here at Richland Creek. Father, help us to steward them well. God, they are a gift that you have given this church. And Father, we pray that as you send them out every week into their communities and in their workplaces, God, that they would represent Jesus well in all that they do. And Father, we pray for us as a church that we would love and serve them well. And so, Father, as you send all of us out today to go live out the gospel, may we represent you in all that we do. Father, we love you, and it's in your Son's name we do pray these things. Amen. You're dismissed.